Thursday. The week has really been going fast. Let's just do a quick recap of what we've covered this week. We started on Monday, and we had a fairly detailed discussion as to how we believe energy is going to be used in the future. We talk about the various factors that will influence how energy is utilized, the cost of energy, for example. We recognize that probably the two most important factors are going to be public policies and scientific and technological developments, okay? We also review the various energy technologies that are currently available, the advantages, the disadvantages. When we look at the current energy technologies, at least for the U.S. and most countries in the world, the very strong dependence that we have on fossil fuels became very apparent, okay? And that is probably the biggest challenge that we have today. How do we displace and replace all those technologies based on fossil fuels with alternative sources of energy? We're going to talk about energy efficiency today. But this is probably the biggest challenge. How do we reestablish a whole new infrastructure the way we produce and utilize electricity? We also talk about the wider energy nexus, and this is very important because sometimes we don't pay a lot of attention to that. But what has happened in California, in the U.S., what has happened in Spain, what happened in Australia in recent years, makes this problem much more real, and this is something that we have to pay a lot of attention to. I show you that it takes a lot of water to generate electricity, whether we use fossil fuels or nuclear reactors. And also, we have a lot of water on the planet. The problem is that most of this water has salt, it's in the oceans, 3/4 of the surface of the earth is covered with water. And we discussed that you also need a lot of energy to purify water. And obviously, without water, we cannot live. It's just that simple. We have to make some tough decisions. Do we use water for power generation, or do we use water for irrigation and to produce food? So these are serious questions, and I show you the example in California where people are having to make some very tough choices as to how do we utilize water. So I encourage you to think about this, and obviously this is going to require some innovation. We talk about separation membranes. There are some technologies that are already available that use osmosis as a process to purify water. The problem with these techniques is that they require a lot of energy. And this is where the water energy nexus comes together. So if we could come up with new technologies that require less energy to purify water, they're gonna make a big difference. That's gonna be a major breakthrough. And some of the technologies that we see coming into the pipeline include things like graphene, where you can modify the surface of graphene and you can break some of these carbon-carbon bonds in graphene to make pores that are just big enough to trap particles or salt and let purify the water go through. So this is a very important area, and many governments are already paying attention to that. And as engineers, I encourage you to think about it. You know, we really need some innovation to come up with good ideas. On Tuesday, we talk about composites. Okay. And as I told you, you could probably take a whole course on composites. This could be a 6-month long project. But the message from composites is, number one, that the availability of carbon fibers in recent years has really made a tremendous difference. And I show you how we are using those carbon fibers for aerospace applications. I show you the video of Boeing, where now you have an airplane is for civilian purposes, the 787, which is made out of composite materials. We have used composite materials in military aircraft for many years, but nowadays we are transitioning that technology into the civilian world. We talk about anisotropy. All these materials are fairly anisotropic, and is the result of embedding two materials with very different elastic properties. The fibers are very stiff, very strong. They get embedded in an epoxy matrix, and that results in a material that is very anisotropic. Mathematically, we know how to handle that. If you took a course on elasticity, all these relationships that you had for stress and strain apply. The difference being that now you need more elastic constants to describe and characterize the behavior of composites. I show you how to derive the rule of mixtures. It's a very simple relationship that gives you a way to calculate the elastic properties of the composite if you know the properties of the constituents and the volume fraction. And then I show you some examples of how we have successfully used composites to make wind turbines, for example, to generate electricity from the wind. We briefly talk about materials that can heal themselves if there is damage, and there are lots of opportunities that we can come in this area. Obviously, we focus on structural applications, but when we talk about composites, we could also think about functional applications. And today I want to give you some examples of how we have made magnets using composite materials. So this is really a very rich field. There is a lot of work going here, a lot of good material science and a lot of good materials engineering involved in this area. Yesterday we focused on solar. Obviously, whenever we talk about solar, we think about photovoltaics. We did a quick review of how photovoltaic materials work. We talk about the Bell Labs and the major contributions that came out of the Bell Labs. We talk about the PN junction. You know, without a PN junction, you could not have a working photocell. That was the real breakthrough, understanding that if you take a P material and an N material and you put them together, you're going to create this depletion zone that creates an internal potential in the material. And that's what prevents the recombination of electrons and holes. And that's what allows the photocell to operate. This, again, was a major breakthrough. The other breakthrough came from the realization that you can dope materials with other elements. Okay, whether it is boron or phosphorus in the case of silicon, you can alter the electronic characteristics, and that's what allows you to make PN junctions. We briefly talk about quantum mechanics, the understanding of how electrons can move in materials to produce an electric current. We also talk about concentrated solar, and this is a very important technology. The idea here is that you use the radiation from the sun, you concentrate it perhaps using mirrors, and then you can heat up a fluid, and that fluid can go through a turbine to produce electricity. Some of the challenges that we have with concentrated solar is what happens when the sun goes away, or if there are clouds in the system. And we talk about the use of molten salts, for example, as a way to store energy. Whenever you use molten salts, you have to be aware of many things. There are some corrosion issues. So you have to make sure that the alloys that you select to make the tubes or the containers for the salts are compatible with the salts. We talk about the stresses coming from temperature gradients. We also talk about photocatalysis. This is a way to generate hydrogen utilizing solar irradiation in certain materials. Now, on Monday, when we talk about catalysis, I told you that we know that catalysis really works. We still don't understand why. And there is a lot that happens whenever an electron interacts with the surface of a material. And this is in the field of quantum mechanics. We have a pretty decent idea of what happens. We still don't know exactly what happens at every moment. There are some very fast reactions with catalytic processes. And again, in the future, we will have breakthroughs if we can really understand all the inside workings of catalysis, because we will be able to replace some of the expensive materials, or actually identify new materials that will have better properties. And we also talk about hydrogen. So if you think about it, we have come a long way this week. We really have covered a lot of material. And today we're going to talk about a very important topic, and that's the topic of energy efficiency, okay? And we want to spend some time talking about thermoelectric materials. These are some of the most, in my opinion, fascinating materials that are available. And I'm going to show you the type of science that is going on trying to understand how these materials behave. And again, once you know how materials behave, then you can take the next step and identify better materials, less expensive materials, materials that are easier to manufacture, materials that can be recycled. You know, all those questions come, and we can find answers if we can understand how materials behave. We'll briefly talk about gas turbines, but this is another area that and this is the topic I would like to use at the very end of the course today, and that's in the area of design of new materials. This is a growing area in material science and engineering. And this is possible because now we have some very fast computers. And we're using those computers to solve Schrodinger's equation. I mean, it really boils down to that. It's using quantum mechanics to understand the properties of materials, and then having the ability to say, I want to design a material that has a Young's modulus of this value, and a thermal conductivity of this value, and a heat capacity of this value, and a magnetic property of this value. We should be able to design materials that do not exist in nature utilizing these tools. So this is an area where you're going to see a lot of work. And again, this is possible because we have some very high, fast computers that allow us to do many calculations over short periods of time. OK, so let's get started. And again, just to recap, this whole course, if there's something that I want you to take with you at the end of this course, is this fact that you know, at the very end, it's a combination of public policies and scientific and technological advances. OK, Thomas Johann Seebeck. He was born in 1770, died in 1831. And he's known for the so-called Seebeck effect, OK? What's interesting is that he discovered the Seebeck effect, but he actually wasn't sure of what he had discovered. And it took a while for somebody to really understand what had happened. So he was actually very hesitant. And that happens with us scientists and engineers. You know, sometimes we find something and we are not sure if what we are measuring is correct. I'll tell you what type of experiments he was doing. But today we're going to be talking about Seebeck a lot. This is one of the most important properties when it comes to thermoelectric materials, OK? So, but look at the date, 1770 to 1831. So we are talking about hundreds of years since he first came into the picture. The other fellow who was also active at around the same time was Peltier. He actually found a related phenomenon that happens when you have temperature gradients in electric currents and magnetic fields. Today, you can buy devices that operate based on the Peltier effect, OK? So this is where these things are coming from. So this, they both were contemporaries. And what happens with Seebeck is that Seebeck did an experiment. And he took two wires of different metals. And he put them together. And then he heated the tip of the wire. So he actually had made a thermocouple. And he heated the wires, and he actually saw a magnetic field. That's what Seebeck had observed. He saw a magnetic field that had been formed on the other end of the wires. And he tried again, and the magnetic field was there. And he wasn't sure about it. And he never published those results. Even though he had written some notes and people had become aware of the work, he was so uncertain about the phenomenon that that was never written, per se. But that is what we know today as thermocouples, OK? And I'm sure, I'm sure most of you have measured temperature using thermocouples, OK? So you have two wires that have to be joined at the very tip. So what you have here is really a p-n junction in some way. If you think about it, you have a p-n junction. And I'll tell you more about that. So you join these wires. And then if you remember, you always have to have a reference temperature for your thermocouple. So a lot of times you have this glass with water and ice, and that's your reference temperature. And what you are really measuring is the gradient between this temperature, where the bead is, and this reference temperature. And then in the old days, this is before we had electronic devices. I remember when I started doing experiments with thermocouples, we had these thermocouple tables. So we will measure the voltage using a very precise voltmeter. And then we will go to some tables. And depending on the voltage that we measure, we have a value of temperature. Okay, so these thermocouples have been calibrated. So in the old days, if you had a course on experimental theory, you had to have access to these tables. And you measure your voltage, and you have to be very careful how you measure your voltage. It has to be a precise measurement. And then from that measurement, you could determine the temperature. And every table was very specific for the type of combination of metals, OK? And the metals have to be different. In this case, chromium and aluminum. And also something very important, you had to have a reference point. In this case, we use copper wires to go from this. In principle, we had another junction here, but that's how we measure the voltage. Today, if you have things like LabVIEW or digital thermometers, all you have to do is just connect the ends of the wires and tells you the temperature. That all the calibration tables are embedded inside the material. So this is the voltage that you measured with this thermocouple. So it's a plot that shows you the voltage in millivolts from 0 to 80. You have temperatures in degrees C from 0 to 1500 C. And these are different types of thermocouples. In the lab, we use type K a lot. You know, you can safely use type K up to probably 1000 degrees C. A lot of the experiments that we do with type K fall in this ratio. So these are fairly robust thermocouples. Something that you want in a thermocouple is a large slope in this curve, so it will give you more voltage per temperature, so that will give you more precision in your measurements. We used to do a lot of work with ceramic matrix composites, and we will take these composites up to 1600 degrees C. So we use type S thermocouples. They're not here in this table. But those were platinum with rhodium alloys. But this is the, you know, for many years, this has been the standard way of measuring temperatures, okay? When you select the materials for your thermocouple, you want to make sure that the materials are stable, that, for example, they will not oxidize. Because if they oxidize, then the voltage that you are measuring are going to be significantly affected. You want to make sure that the thermocouple is compatible with the material that you are measuring, so there are no chemical reactions. So this is the whole operation with thermocouples. And again, you know, this derives from the work of Seebeck. And then if you go to the tables, again, you have the different types of thermocouples, tolerance that you have. And what they've done today, which has been very effective, is that you have different colors to identify your thermocouples. And that makes it easy, because that way you don't mix wires that should not be going with one another. Okay, so this is just a quick introduction. You have used thermocouples. But today I want to focus on this part of the diagram, okay? And this refers to all these gray areas in this energy flow diagram. So if you remember, we have all the sorts of energy on the left, and as we move from left to right, it shows you how these energies are utilized. In the case of coal, most of the coal goes to generate electricity. In the case of petroleum, most of the petroleum goes to transportation. There are some industrial processes. And these are the areas where we really do a very poor job. In the area of transportation, almost 70% of the energy is wasted, is rejected mainly in the form of heat. Even to produce electricity and to transmit electricity, we waste a lot of energy. When we do the overall calculation, you know, 60% of the energy is wasted. And that's going to be the topic for today, energy efficiency. Can we do things to improve on all this energy that gets wasted into these processes? Now, why is energy efficiency important? It is important because a lot of times we are thinking about how many wind turbines should we install, how many photovoltaic panels should we install, how many nuclear reactors should we build. And perhaps the question should be, if we don't build a new nuclear power plant, or if we don't build a new a gas turbine, perhaps we can afford to do that and continue having economic growth if we make better use of energy. I mean, that's what we call in English the low-hanging fruit. This is something that you can do right away. But obviously, as you will see, we'll require some technologies, and that's going to be the focus of today's discussion. So let me show you a video. This is, in my mind, I'm a geek, you know, and I tell people that this is probably my, if I had, I had my list of priorities in life. So this is my third choice in terms of jobs. Doing science is actually my third choice. My first choice was to become an astronaut. I always wanted to become an astronaut. And unfortunately, I had two strikes against me. Number one, I was born in Mexico, so Mexico didn't have a space program, so that was bad. Number two, my eyes were not very good, so I used lenses. And one of the requirements to join the space program, you had to have perfect vision, no corrective vision. So right away, my dream of becoming an astronaut just disappeared. I had a chance to become involved with the space program in 2003 when the Space Shuttle Columbia had an accident, and I was invited to participate in the accident investigation. And if I come back to Spain in the future, I can tell you about it. That was a very sobering experience because we had to do a fractographic analysis of composite materials that are used in the space shuttle. So that was the closest I got to the space program. It was not the ideal conditions. When we were doing the fractographic analysis, they had to recover pieces of the corpses of the astronauts. I mean, it was a very sobering experience. So that was my dream job. You know, that was option one. Option two was to become a tennis player. And didn't happen, so I'm in my third option here. You know, doing science is my third option. But every time I get a chance to be connected to the space program, I really get excited. So let me show you a video. And I hope you guys get as excited as I do when I see this video. About, I think it's 2012, so it's going to be 3 years this summer. It was around 3:30 in the morning, Eastern time. I live in the Eastern time zone in the U.S. And I was watching this live because let me put the video, and then we'll talk about that. So, you know, to me, that is such a remarkable feature. So there is no direct control. This thing is almost autonomous. And when I was watching that real time on TV, the signal took several minutes to go to get from Mars. So these guys were at the Jet Propulsion Lab in California just getting signals, and so they landed. So they didn't, this is obviously a recreation of what really happened, but that's the beauty. I mean, think about the power of the human mind, that we can do this at a long distance. Sometimes people believe that the guys from JPL, they probably overdid it. So you have the parachute. Well, you have first these ablative brakes, and then you have the parachute, and then you have the retro rockets, and then you have the crane. So they kind of show off, you know. In English, we say that, you know, they are show off. But that just tells you about the power of the human mind, the fact that we can do these type of things. This morning we were talking about the autonomous vehicles. You know, in the future we're going to be able to get into a car and the car is going to be driving by itself. The fact that we can do it at a long distance has really set the stage for that in the future. So why am I showing you this? Well, I'm showing you this because when the Curiosity landed, the first thing that they did that you saw that there's like a pedestal with lots of cameras and started getting pictures around. And this was one of the very first pictures that they get. And within minutes when that picture was received by some colleagues at a company called Teledyne, which was connected to Boeing, they were responsible for making the power supply. And as soon as they got the pictures, they emailed them to us. And that's because we were involved in the construction, part of the design and the construction of the power supply. And I'm going to show you the inside of this power supply. Specifically, the lab, we developed some alloys of iridium that we use to encapsulate plutonium, and I'm going to show you where that's coming from. And the other thing that we did, we did some calculations to predict the rate of stress relaxation in some insulation. It's a thermal insulation that we keep that we use to keep the temperatures in the power supply constant. But the design was so ingenious that they were using that insulation as a spring. And this was very important because as the rover was getting into the atmosphere, you talk about G's, he talks about 10 G's of acceleration. All this creates a lot of forces inside the rover, including the power supply. And what they wanted to make sure was that all the components inside the power supply would not be moving around. So they used the insulation that was designed there for thermal purposes as a spring to keep everything in compression. And then they asked us, how fast will that load relax as a function of time? So we made a prediction for 14 years based on some stress relaxation tests that we did at the laboratory. So we were very close to this, and this is why I feel so attached to this program. So what you are looking here is in the back, this is the power supply. And that technology is not new in general. These are called radioisotope thermoelectric generators. And sometimes we will refer to them as RTGs. Radioisotope thermoelectric generators. So we call this radioisotope because we work with an isotope of plutonium. We call this radio because it's radioactive, isotope because it's an isotope, and then we call this thermoelectric. And that's going to be the topic of this morning, thermoelectric materials. And then generator, because it generates electricity. Okay? So that technology is not new. In fact, if you could go to the moon and look at the surface of the moon near the landing sites, what you will find in every case is one of these RTGs. Okay? This is an Apollo mission. You can see here the shadow of the astronaut. This may be Apollo 12 or 14, here is the RTG, and the RTG is here to generate the electricity. You see these cables? This is the cable that provides power to these experiments. They left lots of experiments on the moon, and all the electricity to power these experiments comes from these RTGs, okay? That gives you an idea of the size of the RTG. In the case of the Curiosity, we are talking about something that is probably this big, okay? maybe this big in diameter. You see these fins? These fins are to radiate heat, okay? Because what you want, as you will see here in a minute, you want a steep temperature gradient. You want to go for something that is very hot, something that is very cold. And these fins allows you to radiate heat into space so you can establish a very high temperature gradient. So again, the technology is not new. They have been used in the Apollo program. The only difference is that they have been making some improvements in the type of thermocouples, type of thermoelectric materials that they have used. They've tried to make them a little more compact, more robust, lighter, and obviously the newest concept is the one that is on Mars. In addition to the Apollo program, every probe that has left the region around Mars and Earth has used a thermoelectric generator. So this is a schematic of Galileo. Here is the RTG. You see it here? So here is the RTG. These are some trusses, or some antennas. Galileo was focused on Jupiter. And then at the end of the mission, it was directed to crash into Jupiter. Now, when they developed Galileo, this is very interesting. When they developed Galileo, they did not sterilize the probe. And there was a hypothesis. In fact, they haven't proved it, but they think that some of the moons of Jupiter have water. And they were very concerned that if there was an accident, that Galileo could go and crash into one of the moons. And if there were bacteria, that those bacteria could go and contaminate the moons of Jupiter. So to prevent that possibility, what they did at the end of the mission was just directed and crashed into Jupiter. So this died on the surface of Jupiter. But again, it's so far away from the sun that the only way to provide electricity for all the instruments is using this RTG. So there is one RTG here. There's another RTG here. And we'll see the type of power that they can generate. So if you were to open up, this is the Galileo. We talk about Galileo. The one that is flying right now through Saturn is Cassini. And if you have not seen those pictures, I mean, these are probably some of the most spectacular pictures that you will ever see. This Cassini probe went through the rings of Saturn. And you see some of the pictures, and they are just mind-boggling. So give an idea, it produces 300 watts of electricity. And that's only 7% conversion efficiency. So these materials are not very efficient, okay? And we'll talk about here in a minute. But what's remarkable about these materials is that there's truly no moving parts. So in the case of a turbine, you know, things are rotating at 100,000 RPM. In the case of an internal combustion engine, you have the pistons going up and down. These things don't move, same thing with the solar. However, we have to be aware that there are some temperature gradients, and as I told you, every time you have a temperature gradient, you're going to have a stress. So that's an area of concern here. So we're going to look at this in more detail here in the next slides. But what you have here, all along these lengths, are these thermocouples, okay? So you have two legs. One leg is P-type, and the other leg is an N-type. Okay, and then they are connected here on the top. This is a layer of molybdenum and silicon, and this plate is actually in contact with the heat source. And then on this end, these things get connected in parallel, and these are connected to what's called here the cold shoe, and these are mechanically attached to the fins. So what you want to have is a very steep temperature gradient along the length of your thermocouple, okay? So this is really a thermocouple. If you go back to the schematic I showed you of the in the laboratory where you bond your wires, that happens here. And then on the other end, that's where you collect your voltage. And the whole idea of this technology is that you want to have the greatest temperature gradient that you can generate. The bigger the temperature gradient, the better the response of the thermoelectric, okay? So this is a more detailed view. Look at here all the thermocouples. Can you see them? Each one of these is a thermocouple. and they are arranged in different locations, and then they are connected here in parallel to collect electricity. And these hot shoes, these are the surfaces that are in contact with the hot source. They are physically touching these blocks, okay? And that's what we call here the general purpose heat source. So all these blocks are very special. And if you open up one of those blocks, what you have is this very complex arrangement of components. So the most important part of this component is this so-called fuel pellet, okay? And the fuel pellet is a chunk of plutonium-238. This is a picture of a piece of plutonium-238 just sitting on a surface. It's just glowing red. I mean, it really gets very hot. And the reason why it gets hot, there is a process called radioactive decay, where elements transmute, and when they transmute, they generate a lot of particles. In this case, you generate alpha particles, which are nuclei of helium. And the motion of those helium particles throughout the material creates a lot of collisions. And those collisions generate a lot of heat. So all this heat comes from the collisions of these alpha particles inside the material, okay? And something that we pay attention to, this radioisotope, they are radioactive, is there's something called the half-life, okay? So the half-life of this is about 87, 88 years, which means that in 88 years, half of the atoms will go radioactive decay, okay? So in principle, the amount of heat will decrease with time, but at least in 87 years, the amount of heat will be cut in half, okay? But you could still produce heat for the next 300 years. The amount will be less, but it will continue going through a radioactive decay. So it's an actual picture of the fuel. This requires a special process. This is different from plutonium-239. Plutonium-239 is a byproduct of a nuclear reactor, okay? Plutonium-238 is a very special isotope, and it really requires a lot of work. In fact, to make plutonium-238, you have to create an element called neptunium, which is an artificial element, and then you gotta let it decay, and that's how you get plutonium-238. So it's a very complex process. We are doing some of this at the Oak Ridge National Lab. People at Los Alamos National Lab have also been involved in the production of plutonium. So this is the most important component, this fuel pellet. The other part of the hardware that we do at the lab are these clads, and these are made out of iridium. So the fuel pellet goes inside the fuel clad, and this iridium element, this is one of the most refractory materials that you will ever find. The melting point is close to 4,000 degrees. This is higher than tungsten, wolframium. These are very refractory materials. They are very difficult to process, but we have developed some techniques at the lab at Oak Ridge where we can make these capsules, put the fuel inside, and then weld them to keep the plutonium contained inside the capsule. Now you have this GIS, the graphite impact shell, okay? So everything goes inside these graphite impact shells. And this was a very important requirement because the first time during the Apollo mission, there was not, people were so excited with the space program that nobody really cared about this. But then when we had Cassini and Galileo, people were very concerned, what if one of these rockets explodes? So you have this Galileo or Cassini probe in a rocket, and then you're trying to launch it, and then it explodes. What's going to happen with all the plutonium? And then people were actually demonstrated outside Kennedy Space Center. I mean, they had non-nuclear materials, and we don't want to, if there is an accident, what's going to happen? So they got engaged, and this is actually a composite material. This has carbon fibers in a carbon mesh. It's a carbon-carbon composite. And these are rated to not to break under the worst conditions. So you could take these to 50 Gs of acceleration, and you could crash them, and they will not fracture. I mean, they will crack, but the fibers will keep everything together. So this is one of the nice things about the composite materials, that you can design these materials for impact applications. And this was a requirement, again, just in case of an accident, they wanted to make sure that the plutonium will not be dispersed in the coast of Florida in the case of an accident. And then just to make it safe, so this is the first layer. They wanted to put some redundancy. So all of this goes inside these capsules, and these are carbon fiber composite also. And these are just to make sure that if this were to fail, that this will not fail. So this is just a level of redundancy. You have a double layer of safety to make sure that the plutonium will not escape. And then you put these little cylinders inside these blocks, and these blocks are exactly these blocks, okay? But they get really hot. I mean, over here, you may be close to 1,000 degrees C. Over here, you'll probably be close to 700 degrees C. So these blocks are very, very hot. And what you do is that you attach your thermocouples. This hot shoe is in physical contact with these blocks, which are these blocks, okay? So that's how it works. All the heat comes from the from the plutonium. So these are examples of some of the probes that have used radioisotope thermoelectric generators. We talk about Galileo, okay? In 2003, they crashed Galileo on the surface of Jupiter to prevent contamination. Cassini is going. It has focus on Saturn. The Voyagers, they have actually left the solar system, okay? They actually went beyond the orbit of Pluto, and they keep on going. They are still sending signals. These RTGs are going to be generating electricity for the next 300 years, okay? The amount of power is going to continue to decrease because of the radioactive decay of plutonium, but they will continue producing just enough to keep on sending signals. And they've been sending signals. This is very remarkable. You know, they were launched in 1977. And again, they have left the solar system. There was a very famous scientist in the US. His name was Carl Sagan. I don't know if you have heard about Carl Sagan. Carl Sagan had a program called Cosmos. And he was very involved in these missions. And in fact, he designed some devices that are in Voyager. They have a They have like a CD. It was actually made out of gold that had movies and pictures from the Earth, sounds, music, just in case somebody from another civilization, if they were to capture this, that they will see that there will be that was life on Earth. So you know, this is a very nice story about Voyager. The New Horizons is expected to follow this. It has already passed Pluto. So these are examples of some of the probes that have used RTGs. And the reason why you use RTGs is that you are very far away from the sun. You just cannot use solar panels to collect sunlight to generate electricity. So this is a chart that shows you the electric power level, kilowatts of electricity, as a function of the time of duration. So if you have a mission that is a few days, you may be able to use chemical sources, batteries, okay? So if you have a mission that will last 3 or 4 days, you know, don't make this complicated. Just put some batteries. And you know that the batteries are going to die. But if your mission is going to last, you know, 4 or 5 days, that's going to be okay. The problem is that we are talking about missions that will last, you know, 1-10 years. So the only thing that get close to this time scales are these RTGs. You know, RTGs are probably one of the better technologies. The problem with RTGs is that the amount of electric power that you can generate is not that much, okay? It's not that much. And very interesting, we were involved at the Oak Ridge National Lab developing a reactor, an actual nuclear reactor that will be sent to space. But then with a reactor, this will be a small reactor, smaller than what you have in a submarine, but it will be powerful enough that you will be providing whatever power you need. So if at one point we have a mission that we need to colonize Mars, for example, and you need a lot of power, you're not going to send batteries or RTGs. You're probably going to build a nuclear reactor and take it there, because the amount of power of electricity that you can generate for a very long period of time, this is the only technology that's going to give you those requirements, okay? So it's a good chart. Again, very short term, you can use chemical sources in the form of batteries. The optimal solution will be fission reactors. Radioisotopes are very good, except that you know, the amount of power that you can get is really not that great. And that's what we are trying to do, improve this characteristic.